Welcome, everybody. And this is our Love at First Glance, How Advertising Catches the Consumer. This seminar is part of the Kopenhaver Center Leadership Seminar Series. And we have two outstanding alumni on our panel today, both my students. Okay, Tina Varjabedian. And her first name is so easy, Tina. Marketing and Communication Manager for Aventura Mall. And Noël, Valentine Walter, yes, that's his name, not because it's Valentine's. Noël Valentine Walter, Beauty Advisor, Tom Ford Beauty, Saks Fifth Avenue, Brickell. So they're going to be talking to us about how things have changed, what they would have liked to have known, what makes you more marketable, and I'm going to be asking a series of questions to them. First, I'm going to introduce Tina. It's an open discussion, so I'll ask the questions, they can both answer it. Let me tell you a little bit about each of them. One of them had a little more to say, so, you know, I'll allow that. I did edit. And Tina Varjabedian is a marketing and communication manager for Aventura Mall. That's a 2.7 million square foot center and Miami's premier fashion destination for locals and visitors. It's one of the country's top five highest grossing malls, according to square foot footage. Tina handles marketing strategies, advertising, social media, digital platforms, special events, community and public relations. One person does all that. Previously, she served as a local and regional marketing and community relations manager for Whole Foods Market in Los Angeles. There, she managed the in-store marketing team and social media, developed community programs and community partnerships. She holds a Bachelor of Arts in Communication Studies from California State University, Northridge. Also an FIU graduate, as I said, she earned her Master of Science in Global Strategic Communication. Did you ever notice everything's like 100 words with her? What can I tell you? She's active in organizations. She's held positions in the Public Relations Society of Miami's chapter and on the Graduate Advisory Board of the FIU chapter of the Association for Women in Communications. I was the faculty advisor at that time. Now, Noël, he's our creative brief. So we have less and very concise. He's been a force and a force, I might say, in the fashion and beauty industry for more than 6 years. He's a creative thinker with a wide range of clientele. He's also fascinated with technology. He always was. He was the director of Digivitis. Right? Digivation. Digivation. Sorry, Digivation. I couldn't remember what it was. Digivation. Okay, he was the director of Digivation.
It's a digital innovation.
Digital innovation. Okay, for one of our organizations. I'll come back to that. So he's fascinated with technology and its impact on human interaction. And also an FIU grad, he received his Bachelor of Science degree with a major in advertising. He was the president of the Association for Women in Communications for several semesters. His ingenuity introduced digital communication to the student chapter. Now let's welcome our accomplished speakers, Tina and Noël. I'm going to join them right here. And here they are going, I can't believe we were in class just a little while ago. They're wondering, am I getting a grade for this? No, you're not. You're fine. They're king. Did I learn anything? Okay, so my question, first question is, how has advertising changed since you've gotten into the industry? Tina, you can go first.
I mean, I saw this question and I thought, my gosh, and it's been maybe 5 years since I graduated grad school, and advertising has changed tremendously. Just from the coursework that we took that was focused on more print ads, that's almost non-existent now. From a professional speaking perspective, just in the 2 years I've been with Aventura Mall, we barely do any print anymore. And several different reasons, just because advertising is changing so much more now. Campaigns are so much more short-lived. With that being said, the cost of production is relatively high for printing as opposed to digital. Also with digital, we can feature it in several different places, not just in mall and throughout the mall on large digital screens and digital directories, but also online, and share the advertising and the campaigns with our partners. It just kind of streamlines the process and makes it a lot easier for everyone and a lot more cost effective. So as far as where it's featured between print and digital, there's been a huge change, and some brands are a lot more progressive in adopting the digital advertising platform, and some still like print, which is understandable because with print you kind of realize that you're just one brand, so your advertising still stands alone. When you're digital, it's kind of a rotating loop where it's a great ad, it looks nice, looks progressive, very cutting edge, but then right after you, after your 30-second loop or your 20-second loop, you have another brand associated with your brand. So some brands are still kind of holding back on that and sticking to print, but in general, I would say digital is the future of advertising, at least from a retail perspective.
And Noël, how has advertising changed since you entered the field?
Well, with me, just being able to connect directly with my clients via my cell phone, I can change the message of whatever I want to sell to them. Because a lot of times it's about the relationship that you have with the client. I do more direct marketing. So while I rely on all the advertising that comes from the company and comes from the brand, I do sort of segment what my communication is and to who that message is going to. So I know pretty much what the client is looking for, and I can better fit their need. So technology has really enhanced that, and it's a quick turnaround. I can send a message today and have a sale by tomorrow, or vice versa. I've been working on a sale. Yeah, it's more targeted, and it's just easier to turn around the new products. I don't have to wait for the advertising to hit print, or I don't have to wait for it to hit online. I can send the picture directly. As soon as I see the product, then they can see the product. Like when I go to training, they can get all the information ahead of time so they can start making the decision so they can get it first. Because some of my clients are bloggers, so they want to get the things before everybody else. So they'll reach out to me and say what's going on with this. And so I'll sort of get them the information before it hits the rest of the market so they can think ahead to what they're going to plan their message to be.
Next question, which ties into your answer, is what strategies have you used to strengthen brand bonding with the audience?
At least with me, it's just like living the lifestyle of the brand a lot of times. It's using it in social media and wearing it and talking about it and living the lifestyle of the brand, because that's what's going to engage your customers. That's what's going to get them to come back to you. It's once you hit a lifestyle point of like what they want to do with their life, you sort of like know what they're going to need in their life. So I can think of someone's wardrobe now, and I can think of everything that they're going to need to go out with. I had dressed a client for New Year's Eve, and he told me of the place he was going and what he wanted to, like kind of wanted what he wanted to achieve. So we put an outfit together. It was like a white jacket with pants and a shirt, and we went around and picked all the different items. It was like, you know, at the end it was like a $3,000 sale at the end of the day. So it was pretty quick and easy. So those are the strategies that I sort of like identify what their need is, and I try to find what product we have to meet that need, as well as think of what their lifestyle is.
So it's blending the brand with their reality.
Yeah.
With their own personal reality. Tina, did you want to add anything to that?
Sure. I mean, from my perspective, it's so important to really engage someone on a personal level. So what we started doing with Aventura Mall from an advertising perspective is really taking these global advertising campaigns that some of these big brand retailers have, that, you know, these campaigns are developed and featured all over the world. And what we did is kind of network with the corporate offices of these retailers and said, you know, this is an amazing advertising campaign, and for certain markets it may work, and you know, for a global market it may work, but we want to promote Cartier for Aventura Mall. So what makes Cartier and Aventura Mall special, and how can we get the Miami customer and our local audiences to want to come and shop here? Because, you know, they can see this advertising campaign online, and our biggest competition is e-commerce. Everyone likes to shop online. And global ad campaigns are amazing and perfect for that. But what are we doing to drive foot traffic to the actual store and make that conversion to a purchase that, you know, they can come in, walk in, touch, experience, and take home? So what we started doing is taking product and shooting it in different environments in the local community and the local market. That can be anything from the beaches here in Miami to one of our partner hotels, which is the Turnberry Isle or the Fountain Blue, or even in the center itself, and promoting that and featuring it and boosting it across our platforms, like social media and advertising campaigns that we feature in the mall and send out to our travel partners as well. So it's been a lot of taking this big regional global campaign and getting really granular and making it local and engaging to our media audiences locally.
that word global and local is glocal. And they're no, it's an actual word that they're using. And it's in my blueprint book, and I talk about that, taking the message. Sometimes it's the same message in other places. Sometimes you have to modify it and really localize it. So that glocal idea is happening, and so it really exists. When you read about this, it's the real word. It's like edutainment is a real word, advertising and education. Mm-hmm. So it's entertainment and education. It's called edutainment, and it does exist, not a fake word. Okay, ready for the next question?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, where do you see the brand and audience engagement changing? How is the audience engagement with the brand, the interactions? How do you see that shifting or growing or being modified?
A lot of consumers now, I think, are looking for a closer relationship with the brand. So they're reaching out to through the social media, whatever conduit is available to them, to connect with the brand, to find out more about where the brand is going. They utilize it. And a lot of times they'll outreach to me and ask questions specifically about, you know, what events are we having coming up with the brand and what's going to be new for in terms of product. And we just sort of like have the rapport back and forth, at least with my clientele. They want to know more, and it's easier for them to make decisions on what they want to buy when they know what's available.
So they're going to the brand for the information, not just waiting for the brand to give them the information. So they're always talking more about interaction and engagement, and that really is a perfect example of that. Tina, what are you finding in the Aventura Mall?
Absolutely, pretty much what Noel said as well. For example, we have one platform specifically dedicated to real-time engagement. So if someone comes to the Aventura Mall, they don't even need to tag Aventura Mall. We have we work with an agency called Local Measure that they use geolocation. So if someone posts something from Aventura Mall and their location services are on, we detect that. It goes in different funnels that we have, whether you know it's a complaint about customer service or they're looking for something in the food court or they're looking for a specific store, and we have someone 24 hours on hand responding to them, engaging with them, letting them know where they are. Because I mean, again, shopping now is all about creating an experience and so much less about actually buying something. So overall, from the moment they come into the parking lot, which is something we engage with a lot, parking issues, to them walking into the mall, looking for the store they want, down to the product and the color they want, we're constantly engaging with them. So it's not just up to the store anymore or the sales associates in the stores or the teams. From a mall perspective and a mall branding perspective, we really want to be known as engagers with our local community and our international community, because as you all know, Miami is a huge international market feeder, and we're constantly engaging with international fans and followers as well via social media, and constantly staying relevant with whatever they have going on in their countries. For example, if there's Carnival going on, we're doing a marketing campaign or an advertising campaign and engaging our international audiences as well. So it's staying consistent, definitely staying consistent, and knowing who your different audiences are, from all the way from adults to teenagers to children, and different ways to communicate to each one's and the best method to reach them as well.
What's interesting, I had read that the area before you enter the shopping center or the store is called the decompression zone, meaning you're already coming into the shopping experience before you enter the venue. So you're already getting into that place. So they're actually marketing to you before you enter the store or the mall. And a lot of people don't realize that they're being marketed to. And which direction do you think most people walk when they go into a store, right or left? What do you think the highest percent, they walk in and go right, or they walk in and go left?
To the right.
You're correct. So therefore, if you want to do something different, go to the left, you'll feel very odd. It's like, well, I'm going the wrong way. It's an odd experience. Try it. Go in somewhere and go to the left. You're like, oh, I don't know about this. So a lot of the marketing is to the right. A lot of things, because they know you're going that way. Just thought you'd be interested. Okay. Ready for the next question? What changes do you anticipate in advertising and marketing? From what you've seen up to now, what are you seeing that you think a big shift will happen? Or you're seeing evidence of something shifting in advertising and marketing? That it hasn't quite happened yet, but you're seeing an indication that it might.
I was watching this thing on TED.com, I think this week, and it was saying how websites are tracking everywhere you go from the moment you click in your cookies, but it's not just that one website. They link to a bunch of other websites. So you could have like 20 websites following you before you know, you finished breakfast just by searching on your phone. So I think advertising is going to become way more individualized. We see it in our scrolling. So when we go to a website, you'll see something that you looked up recently, and mm-hmm. it'll be from your cookies. It'll be, oh, you were looking for these sneakers? Well, we have them here. Mm-hmm. You're looking you were looking for this phone? Well, we have, you know, it in every color. So it shows you in the ads whatever you're searching. So a lot of the ads have become very individualized. They want to know the consumer behavior. They want to know where they're shopping, why they're shopping, what colors they like. Mm-hmm. They'll start to market you based on color, age. Once they identify, you know, how old you are, what your interests are, they can pretty much decipher your lifestyle and sort of market to you much easier, knowing what you have available to you, and as well as, you know, because you put everything in there from your credit card information to your bank information to your address. They know what area you're living in. They said, oh, this new place just opened up. They'll send you a flyer. So
how do you think that affects people who are choosing to block ads? Because a lot of people are offended by this. Like, I don't want you to know that much about me. I can see some of you nodding your heads. You're like, well, you know, it's like somebody's watching you all the time. Do you think the ad blocking community is getting stronger?
It's getting stronger, I think, too, because it's you have to be an advocate for people that are underage. Like, you know, they shouldn't be tracked. You know, if somebody was mm-hmm. following around your child 24 hours a day,
yeah.
you would be creeped out, you know. So
yes.
You have to think of it in terms of safety. But for me, it's good and bad because it markets to me and I know exactly what I want. So it'll mm-hmm. show me everything I was looking for. Oh, I remember. Oh, I need this thing. So it'll pop up. So it's good and bad, and it'll get me to buy it. So it's good and bad. It's fulfilling a need, but then it's also, you know, invasion of privacy. So that's a huge segment of the consumer protection mm-hmm. department that hasn't been explored yet, that hasn't been deciphered as to what's crossing the line, you
right.
know,
it's
in terms conflicting, of what they're tracking.
And yet some of us are happy to see, oh, yeah, I forgot about it. I was going to get that. And others are like, oh, who told you I was looking for this?
Yeah.
Okay, Tina, so what are you seeing as a shift?
I mean, Noel spoke, he said the word lifestyle a couple of times, and I kind of want to focus on that word because that's a big word that's thrown around in advertising lately. I think one of the biggest shifts and trends that I've personally seen in advertising and I think is happening and will continue to dominate the world of advertising is lifestyle-driven advertising and campaigns. I think we see it a lot now, and it will only continue to strengthen because buying and purchases are so much less about the actual product now and so much more about what it says about you personally and how it makes you feel. And that word feeling's a big, big word we toss around in advertising too because, you know, you're not just buying, you know, this phone, this Apple phone. You're buying it because what it says about you and how it makes you feel when you connect with other people who have iPhones. You know, just if I meet someone new and I'm texting them and my text goes in green instead of blue, I say, whatever, not an iPhone user. You know, so
or handwritten.
Yeah.
Exactly. I mean, I don't even remember the last time I got a handwritten note. But with that being said, it's just a lot of the advertising campaigns that we see now, if you really pay attention, you will see so much less product and a direct call to action to purchase the product and so much more of this lifestyle element in advertising because they're not telling you buy this product. They're not telling you the what. The product was the what before. They're telling you more the why and the how. And the why and the how being why this product or this brand should be a part of your lifestyle and how it should be a part of your lifestyle. And that how is really where that product is sourced, what materials they're using, where it's coming from, what it represents. So I think being mindful of community and sourcing is a big trend in advertising right now, and it's really shown in advertising campaigns.
And community outreach programs and social causes that they support. A lot of people are making purchases depending on the social causes they support.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And one of the greatest examples I can think of that I can point out to you all is we work with a lot of luxury brands at Aventura Mall, and I want to talk about luxury a little bit because some of the bridge brands and the value brands, they're a lot more open and lenient, and I think generally that's because they have a younger audience. But when you talk about luxury brands, it's a much more qualified consumer, and with that in mind, the brands have a lot stronger guidelines as far as how they market and how they advertise. So When I started 2 years ago with Aventura Mall, it was extremely difficult to get luxury retailers to do anything outside the box and to partner them with different organizations or companies. And just last year, UNICEF formed a partnership, I should say Louis Vuitton formed a partnership with UNICEF. And it all made us kind of like tilt our head and think, that is so random that, you know, Louis Vuitton would do something like that, because, you know, they're about, you know, high lifestyle and luxury, you know, one of the biggest luxury names out there. And all of a sudden they started, you know, featuring a campaign, a UNICEF campaign in Africa, and creating a product set. I believe it was 5 bracelets, 3 rings, and 2 pins. And that was their feature product on their website across their advertising campaigns, that Louis Vuitton is giving back to UNICEF and part of a much larger global cause than just selling luxury goods to luxury audiences.
Makes a statement. It makes you say, wow, they're really doing something for others.
Yeah, I think for the qualified customer too, philanthropy is a big thing. So when they can do that through their fashion, I think they knew that was a market. So, mm-hmm. And when at least the expertise that goes into luxury brands like Tom Ford, I don't just speak about Tom Ford as just a perfume, a beauty brand. It's also a global lifestyle brand. He has clothing. He's also a photographer. He was an architect. He's an architect. He is a model. He does his own ad campaigns most of the time. So he's much more than just a man. It's more the whole brand. So everything that has to be on message, and you really have to know the consumer, and you have to be educated on the products and the way that Mr. Ford thinks about the products and how he wants to incorporate it into his client's lifestyle. Because he says the Tom Ford customer is him. It's his lifestyle. It's on the go. It's someone who's globetrotting, someone who has a high amount of resources available to them, but someone who likes expensive things but doesn't necessarily like to be gaudy or overdone. So you'll see a lot of simplicity in his designs, but they're also just meant to be very symbolic of someone that's a little bit more in touch with the aesthetics of things, but also the impact of them, you know?
It's understated elegance and refinement, mm-hmm. without having to scream it. Sophisticated. Okay, what did you wish you knew before you left school to enter the workplace? What's the thing that you said, gee, if I only knew this, my life would have been so much easier?
That probably all of your classmates will help, you know, shape the course of your life. So all the relationships you have from now until you graduate will help you in the trajectory of your life. So I got my first job from someone I met in one of your classes. So
there you are.
That's
happy me.
That was part of the great trajectory of my life. And a lot of them I keep in contact with. Tina, we became friends through a mutual friend who also went to school here. And it's impacted my life greatly because I've been able to do so many different things. But I've also had a really good emotional bond with my classmates, and sort of it's enhanced my life in so many ways, and I can't even speak to it. So
it's sharing a parallel path.
Yeah.
You might be doing different things, but because you started together, there's something about achieving parallel paths and watching each other grow.
And creating opportunities for, you know,
sharing
for your friends.
Tina, what was your
A very personal question for me, because this is something I've thought about so many times over and over again. Like, if I had to do it all over again, would I do it? And if I was, how would I do it differently? So personally, I did my, you know, undergrad in California, and that's something that everyone just does, as far as, you know, you have to get a bachelor's degree. But going to grad school was a very difficult choice, and I'm very happy that I did do it. But with that being said, what I wish I did more while I was in school is get out there and network more, a lot more internships, and get a job, even if it was any job, like assistant marketing coordinator, any job, even if you're starting at the bottom, just get your foot into the door and start working in the field you want to do. And if you can't get a part-time job in marketing or advertising or whatever your field is, intern. And if it's not a paid internship, do a free internship. Anything you can do to make connections and get any type of skill set under your belt is only going to add to your experience and your resume, and really going to help develop the skills. Because what happens is things are changing so fast in the world of marketing and advertising and communication. If you're in your undergraduate program now, the things you learned in your first 3 years are probably going to be almost irrelevant by the time you're in your like second and third year of working. So you really have to just be in there at all times, read articles, educate yourself. A lot of us take it for granted as, you know, when I graduate college, I'm gonna have a job because I'm gonna have a degree. Education is super important. And I mean, I'm a huge advocate of education, but at the same time, it's one thing to learn something in a classroom, but completely different when you have to apply it in the marketplace and market yourself. So anything you can do to get out there and get some real world experience while you're in school, because that's the time where you could really apply the theories and the courses you're learning to real life hands-on experience is very invaluable.
So it's self-educate and stay current.
Yeah,
always be learning.
Yes.
The skills, you just mentioned skills. What key skills do you think would make someone more marketable in the industry? So if you're thinking, gee, I'm gonna hire somebody, what would you be looking for if you were doing the hiring today? What skills do you think would really move somebody forward?
I think it's a two very, very basic things, and sometimes in the world of interviews and applying for positions, we always try to, you know, over-market ourselves, but what I look for, and it really comes down to very basic things, is having an open mind, but at the same time, staying true to your beliefs and what you feel, because a lot of times as marketers, we try to be all things to all people, and you can't be that way. But having an open mind to new ideas, new concepts, will really help. I really do believe will help you get ahead. I still remember when Facebook came out, and it seems like it was yesterday, but it was actually a very long time ago. And I thought, like, gee, what an awkward concept. Like, how does someone post a picture and this software kind of detect who's in that picture? Like, the idea was so weird
alien.
To me.
Alien.
And I resisted for a very long time. And that's still when Facebook, you had to be in college to have a Facebook account. And I resisted for such a long time. And then fast forward for 2 years, and everyone had Facebook. And I'm thinking, oh my God, I don't even know how to use this thing. Of course, I called my friend Noël because he knows how to use everything tech. And again, that goes back to what he was saying about networking, because anytime I've had anything technology related or presentation related or even organizing apps on my phone, he's my go-to person. But at the same time, I say staying true to your beliefs too, because again, just because everyone's jumping ship on a new technology or something new or a new way of thinking, or even what you just believe in general, it doesn't mean just because it's right for the majority, it's right for you. And sometimes being the person that says, okay, let's hold our horses and see what we are doing right before we jump into changing that, can really save you a lot of time and sometimes even failure in marketing campaigns or the way you choose to market your brand.
That's interesting. So you're saying it sometimes it's good to fail because you learn from it and you grow from it. And also changing your opinion from what you thought was correct yesterday, it's called a paradigm shift, where you thought this was right, and suddenly you find out, well, maybe that wasn't right, and maybe I need to rethink that, and then you have a change in the way your perception is of whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
I think growth, any kind of growth like that, will make you not only a better marketer, but a better person in general. You'll grow exponentially when you start thinking like that. You talk about opening your mind. An old quote, you know, minds are like parachutes, they only function when open. And I often think about that, because it's true. I wanted to allow others to have questions. I know you're sitting there thinking, I want to speak to them, I have a question. So anybody here who would like to ask a question of our brilliant alums, please raise your hand and we'll be happy to allow you to ask the question. Okay, Augusta.
Tina.
Yes.
How do you understand all the cultural groups you have to deal with in Aventura Mall?
I wish there was one specific answer and one medium or one tool to say, you know, I took a multicultural class in grad school and that's how I learned. But no, because as I said before, it's even cultures are changing all the time, and the way we communicate is changing all the time. But as much as I love technology and, you know, my phone saves my life so many times throughout the day, I feel it's really important to take the time to have real conversations with real people off the screen, and I think that's where your mind opens up the most to understanding different people and different cultures, because there's, you know, you can see, you can read words or you can read text and you can read about how different cultures are and the way they interact and the way they communicate, but until you experience it in person and, you know, you feel that energy, not just what's, you know, in a book or what you've heard from other people, I think that's where the biggest cultural growth comes from, and your knowledge expands on the way different people communicate, and you start understanding people better when you start putting the phone down and putting all the articles away and experience someone or something they're saying for yourself in person.
Being fully present.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And really there. And listening to how other people are thinking. And
I mean, I can just add to when, you know, we had our class, the Saturday morning, 7 a.m. class. It was pretty incredible that, you know, it was a class on advertising campaigns in the graduate program. And we had so many different students in our class.
It was right here, the first floor.
I forget what country he was from. He was from an Arab country.
Oh, I know who you're thinking.
That you still keep in touch with.
I'm always in touch with him. He's not from Jordan. I'm always in touch with him. Why do I know?
He was from Syria.
Syria. That's it.
He was from Syria. And it was so interesting Nasser, exactly. To see the way different audiences and different students from different cultural backgrounds engage with the advertising campaigns we were studying. And one of the classes was to come up with our own advertising campaign. And it's so interesting to see how people from different cultures respond to different advertising campaigns and products, but more so interesting to see how they would create a campaign for the same product. I mean, you can say, sell me this phone, and 10 different people will have completely different way of selling you that phone based on their cultural beliefs and background.
And you learn that just by being with other people. You can't learn that from reading about it. You know, just participating and creating campaigns together and listening to how they're thinking, it's enriching. It's very enriching. That class was an interesting class because we always have different people from different parts of the world. But these are really people from really different parts of the world, not just different parts of the country. They're from all over. It was a very interesting, it was an engaging experience for the students and as well as for myself, because I would hear very unexpected answers. I had a student one time from India, and I said in class, let's do a campaign for milk, and she objected, and she said, I can't do that. And we voted and came up with a second campaign idea, and half the class did one and half the class did the other, because I wanted the students to do the same product so you could experience different ideas and share the ideas. And she couldn't do milk. And I'm thinking, I wouldn't have thought of that would be something objectionable. How would I even think about that?
Right?
But it was because the student was from India. She said, I can't do that. I'm going, you can't say, well, yes, you will. No, okay, fine. No, I'm the professor. If you want it, great, of course not. So I'm very respectful of that, and things that I didn't know about. I said, well, I didn't know that was something that would be offensive.
Even me engaging with different clients on a daily basis, I have a lot of clients from Asia. So a lot of clients from Asia don't like a very strong scent. So I usually have to start with a lighter scent, and they're also very tech savvy. So they usually come in with a picture of like what they're looking for, and they'll text back and forth. So it's easier to communicate with the Asian market, at least for me. And a lot of my Arab Indian market tend to like ouds. So we have a lot of oud fragrances. So I focus more on that. So I think, you know, once you know more about the client and what they're into, then it's easier to market to them directly. So.
Well, it was interesting because Milk was trying to introduce milk to China, and they're like, you know about that, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I don't know about this, kind of strange. And so they added flavors from the area, jasmine and different flavors to make milk seem more palatable. So that's where you take something that's, yes, it's an international, well, who doesn't drink milk? A lot of people don't. And you do something to localize it and make it relevant, right, and more palatable for that particular market. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, you wouldn't wear black to a funeral in Japan. You'd wear white. And you wouldn't have the bride wear white in China or India. You'd wear red. So just understanding even what colors mean in different cultures expands your understanding of different audiences. Did anyone else have a question? Okay.
When we were talking about partnerships and philanthropy, is it a process of like waiting for someone to come up with like, I guess, a pitch or like a contract or an idea? Or do you have to go through the process of searching for a collaboration because you partnering with someone else will reflect your brand and everything else as well? So like, what exactly is that selective process like?
And aligning a brand with a cause, what is that process? That's a good question. What is that process?
Yeah, I mean, it's an excellent, Noel, you want to start?
No, you can start.
No, you do it. leave me out of this.
It's an excellent question because we come across that a lot. There are some brands that will go ahead and take initiative to align themselves with a cause or philanthropy-driven campaign. And for that, you know, they do it based on brand guidelines and they like to do that. So some of the bigger brands that they're global, their philanthropy campaigns are driven, you know, globally from their corporate offices. Sometimes brands are more resistant to do that, which in that case, at Aventura Mall, at least I can say we've had a big opportunity to network with local causes and organizations and charities and kind of see who their, I guess, organization base is and partner them with brands we think that they would like. For example, Miami does Fashion Week, and we wanted to, you know, host a Miami Fashion Week event with Miami Modern Luxury Magazine. So we wanted to have informal models there, modeling while we were having this event, so we decided to partner with the Chapman Partnership, and they have a young professionals committee, which mostly consists of doctors, lawyers, professors even, and business people in which what we call the Henrys in the marketing world, which means I think high earning, not yet rich. The Henry, high earning, not yet rich. So, not rich yet. Yes, not rich yet. So we partnered with them, and we chose to partner them with actually DVF in the mall because we felt that they would be a good match. And what they did was had a meeting together and presented that okay. Whenever Chapman Partnerships shops at DVF for this day, they'll get a percentage off, and they'll get a special signed edition book from Diane von Furstenberg herself. So sometimes the brands do it on their own from a much more global perspective, and sometimes they want to focus much more locally, even if they're partnering with a local blogger or an influencer. And with that being said, I think the route of doing local influencers and bloggers and community members is a lot bigger actually now than doing these very large global philanthropy campaigns, at least what I've seen from a fashion perspective for fashion brands.
Did you want to add to that?
Well, at least with me, because we sell a bunch of different brands at my store, it really depends on the brand. So our store would have to, usually our marketing manager would have to partner with our corporate office to see what brands can align with certain organizations. So obviously, you know, if I work for Tom Ford, I can't do a brand with PETA because, you know, Tom Ford sells, you know, fur. So we kind of have to like align and see what's the best fit, and we can make a pitch for it, but we can't always change the mind. You always have to see if the brand is helmed by, usually by a person, they're sort of influenced by who their friends are. If their friend is doing something, like who's the U2 guy? What's his name?
Bono.
Whenever he does something, you know, he'll have his friends partner with him because they have celebrity relationships. So a lot of times, it's if the brand is run by an individual or if it's run by by a corporate office of brand managers and things that are a little bit more open to working with different organizations because it doesn't reflect on them, you know, personally. It reflects on the brand, but usually, obviously, they try to partner with something that's going to reflect on the brand positively. But that's usually the process for that.
Yeah, and I think the brand always has to think about how it positions itself and promotes itself and how it relates to its audience and how the audience relates to those areas where they're funding something or sponsoring something. So when you look at Ben & Jerry's, for example, you automatically think Ben & Jerry's and natural and organic, and you because that was their initial brand. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many of you know that American Express is heavily tied to feeding and those who are hungry. They have a whole campaign about, you know, healthy and hungry, and there's a whole month where they donate. And oftentimes you don't realize that there's an initiative right from the base of the company. The core company has some interest in a social problem or cause that they're trying to address, and it starts there.
Absolutely.
off, and then they find partners who are interested in what their brand has to say. So it sometimes goes the other way around, I think, as well. Any other questions? Okay.
Hi. Thanks, guys. This is for Tina. It's more process-based question.
Sure.
You were mentioning that when you work with big companies, they have guidelines under which they have to, you know, develop their marketing campaigns, et cetera, et cetera.
Sure.
And when you want to localize these campaigns, I can imagine that it's a back and forth thing. So I want to know how that works. Do you, as Aventura's marketing team, take on for these companies and do the photo shoots and the processing yourself, or does it go to their offices in Miami? Because I know that these companies are pretty strict with, you know, the way that they frame their photos, the way that their name goes out. So how does
absolutely
that work?
She's asking about marketing guidelines.
Right, and it's an excellent question, because a lot of what we spend our time doing is kind of trying to juggle and balance, you know, how we're going to promote. So what we do from a very methodical standpoint, I can explain to you, is, you know, we'll look at the sales report every month and see, you know, what stores are trending well and what stores are not trending so well. And we'll approach the retailers and say, you know, a lot of times retailers will approach us and say, you know, we're not doing well, what's going on, there isn't enough mall traffic. So we'll say, you know, this, and this are the marketing opportunities that are available to you from a complimentary perspective and also from a business development perspective, because we have a whole set of what we offer complimentary to our retailers, and then there is a business development perspective where they could purchase advertising in the mall. So from a complimentary perspective, that's where we start. And we say, you know, social media is available to you. We can come into the store. We could do a Facebook Live store if you have, you know, a new collection that just hit the store. Or we can do an Instagram story if you want to, you know, demonstrate how a certain product is used or a certain product is styled. And then we can include you in our quarterly photo shoots for our social media campaign. Some of the times they will say yes, and, you know, they're all for it because they want to help their sales in any way that they can. And of course, we explain to them, you know, if we're going to promote you on Facebook, it's going to be a very targeted post because, you know, you can select who your audience is, your age group, your demographic. So that helps them a little bit more, because often the resistance with promoting on social media is, well, there is no direct ROI. How are you going to track the sale? You know, it's not like you can click and it takes you to an e-commerce website and someone can purchase from there. They really want to see, okay, if I let this team come in and do this into my store with my product, how is that going to increase sales? So that's something we kind of just have to work through and explain to them. So we will explain to them what the opportunities are, try to, you know, understand them and talk to them about what their brand guidelines are and find a happy medium. So we have moved to an amazing place in the last year where a lot of stores that have been very resistant in the past have been a lot more open. But again, we're extremely mindful with the brand and how we group the brands with each other. And if we are going to do a photo shoot, for example, or we're going to go in and do an Instagram story, we will shoot everything beforehand, group it together, piece it together, present it to the retailer, get their approval, make tweaks on the feedback, and then feature it on whichever platform we're going to do. When we do that, it's a lot easier to do that with certain platforms, but when you're doing, you know, your Instagram stories or your Snapchat stories or you're doing anything live, it kind of takes away the authenticity of it. So that's something we're trying to kind of find a balance and explain to the retailers too. But anything we can do at this point to help their sales while maintaining their brand integrity will only help our retailers and sales, which in turn helps Aventura Mall as a brand. So it's just communicating what the opportunities are and understanding what they're open to and what will work for them, really.
But like when you mentioned that Cartier did a localized Miami campaign with like taking pictures on the beach,
right,
taking pictures wherever, does your team take control of that, or does Cartier's team in Miami take control of that?
Our team will take control of that.
So you set up the photo shoot, et cetera, et cetera.
Yes, we set up everything in-house, and we hire photographers and we hire a stylist. And oftentimes a creative director to lead the photo shoot. Cartier will give us suggestions and give us product with what they would like featured, but as far as the process of facilitating and executing a photo shoot and a campaign in general, down to copywriting, what captions and where it's going to be featured and presented, that's on our team.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Were there any other? Okay, go ahead, Reese.
Hi. I was wondering which aspects of your respective fields have shocked you the most since you graduated.
What has shocked you the most in the industry since you graduated? Something that caught you by surprise, you didn't expect that, oh my goodness, how did that happen?
For me, it's been most recently I've noticed the way that politics can shape people's spending. So a lot of policy changes, at least the most recent one with our immigration, has stopped a lot of people from coming into the country and a lot of people from getting out. So sometimes it's a challenge with certain clients bringing them back into the store, even things that are going on in their own country where they're not allowed to come here and spend. Like in Venezuela, a lot of the Venezuelan clients that we had, they couldn't come over and spend because the government was tracking every single thing that they were spending. So they would have to get things in cash or they would have to move money around. So it became a challenge for us, at least in my previous store, where we'd have to be like, oh, is this fraud or is this like a real thing? Like they would have to move money around. So you would be thinking like, is this a legitimate transaction or is this just the way they have to do it now because their country is watching them? And so it's just really shocking to see how those little policy changes or big policy changes can really affect the way people are spending and the way they are living their lifestyle. It's their buzzword for today, lifestyle.
Tina, did you see anything shocking since you graduated?
Well, it's interesting because my major was actually global communications and I ended up in marketing. And they're two very, very different things. I am a marketing and communications manager, but I think being in school, we did a lot of, you know, studying advertising campaigns and coming up with advertising campaigns and marketing to different audiences. And I was really excited to get out of grad school and, you know, create marketing campaigns and the whole creative aspect of it and communicating with people. But a lot of advertising and marketing is a lot of analysis too. And that's something that was extremely shocking to me because I was so excited about the creative aspect. But you know, you can be have a great creative mind, but when you can't show the numbers and how it's affecting trends and sales, all that creativity just kind of dwindles. So again, it's maintaining a very fine line and a balance between doing what you can do creatively, but at the same time, being able to show your results. So as marketers, at least personally, I was always good at, you know, English and art and music and writing and creative writing. And I had to, you know, retake math like maybe 3 times. And I'll admit it, I'm not shy. I had to take math maybe like 3 times in undergrad. But now I realize the importance of, okay, you know, we have these great ideas and these great concepts and these great campaigns. But at the same time, we have to show, you know, hard proof of what we're really doing here and how, you know, we're shifting the numbers and showing why our creativity should be valued and is valuable to what we're doing.
Accountability.
Absolutely.
Not just creativity. Oh my goodness, it has to really work. Yeah. Oh, and produce results. Oh, and make sales.
Yeah, you have to be very, very adaptable. The right brain, left brain has to be working together. One can't be a weakness. So if you have a weakness now, now's your time to concentrate on it. Like if you have to take math 3 times, take math 3 times. If you have to take creative concepts 4 times, so just so you can get it, because a lot of times if you're a left brain, you're not really thinking with the right brain, so the concepts are just foreign to you and you don't understand how they relate. But once you have that adaptability, it just opens up a whole new world for you.
Mental fluency.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Yes.
As you guys reflect on any type of suggestions and recommendations for us, you touched on earlier about marketing yourself. I was wondering if you had any personal stories or just a personal shift you've had to make through that transition of graduating and then like adulting and grasping the opportunities that you're looking for.
The question is about marketing yourself after you graduate. What
self-promotion.
Self-promotion. what things did you need to do or did you do or could you tell us a story?
Right. It's an excellent question. When I graduated, I'm from Los Angeles, and when I graduated graduate school, I wanted to stay here. And I was a grad student while I was in school. I was a grad student for actually Professor VR, who's sitting back there. And so upon graduation, I was like, oh my God, you know, I need to find a job and I wanted to do something in marketing. And as a grad student, I was kind of on this high horse. Well, I have a graduate degree, so I should get hired somewhere. You know, I spent all this time in school. I spent all this money. I know all these things. I'm so excited. I'm going to get a job easily, but that's not the case. It is such a competitive marketplace. And more so, I feel that when people hire you, yes, you know, your skills and your education and your experience are really important, but during an interview, at least, they're really buying you. You know, they're really hiring you and they're buying into you. So I took a position with Whole Foods on Whole Foods Market on the West Coast. The pay wasn't very high at all. So I can tell you honestly that I was making more before I went into grad school rather than after. So it really kind of takes a toll on a hit on your ego that, you know, yeah, I understand the concept of starting somewhere, but I want to be making, you know, all this money. But I can honestly say that I cannot explain to you how many people since I've left Whole Foods have said, oh my God, you worked for Whole Foods, tell me about that. And I took that position with so much resistance, thinking, oh my God, I cannot believe I'm gonna be paid this little. But yeah, I stuck it out, I did it for 2 years. It was, an incredible experience. I met incredible people. And I made it work and I budgeted accordingly. But now that looking back, I think, wow, sometimes you just have to get in somewhere and do what you need to do to get to the next step. And it goes back to what I was saying earlier, start marketing yourself from now. I'm a huge, huge advocate of LinkedIn too. I've reached out to, I don't even know how to count how many random people. I mean, I would research, you know, marketing directors of companies. I had a phone interview when I lived in LA and I was looking for a job with the VP of marketing for NBA in New York, because I found him. I'm like, oh wow, he's the VP of NBA. I'm just going to shoot him an email on LinkedIn, never thinking he would respond. And he did. And I wouldn't say it was a phone interview, but I just kind of wanted to learn like where he got to, where he did, how he recommends, you know, I kind of find what I want to do, because a big part of what you're talking about is kind of, okay, I'm in marketing or advertising or communication, what do I want to do? You know, you don't graduate with a doctor title or a lawyer title. Like, there's so many things you can do in marketing and advertising and communication. So just talk to people in the industry. A lot of times you're going to get shut down, but, you know, maybe out of the 20 people you reach out to, if, you know, 2 to 5 of them, let's say 2 of them even respond to you, you know, that's 2 people's insight that you wouldn't have had if you didn't spend the 2 hours in your week reaching out to people and trying to network. So I know networking is a big word. Sometimes it's intimidating. Sometimes it's boring, actually. It's a very boring word sometimes. But it does work. It really does work. If you try to reach the right people, everyone was where you were once too, so were we, and people are much more willing to help than you think they are. So don't be afraid to reach out to even random people and strangers and random companies and let them know your situation and talk to them and just see where it goes.
I think an interesting point there is that even if you take a job where you feel devalued, that became an invaluable experience. Mm-hmm. So it was valuable, but not in a financial way. It paid its dividends in a different way. I think that was good. Any other questions that you would like to ask? Now's the time. Don't be shy. Nobody has a question? Well, I have a question. So,
of course you do.
When do I not have a question? So where do you see yourselves 5-10 years from now? What are your feet? Well, they're going, that's a good question. And what are the goals, your life goals, and career-wise that you're setting up for yourself now that you plan to achieve? Not wish to, plan to achieve.
For me, I know it's brand management, because after I graduated, I started with Tom Ford as a specialist for fragrance, and then he started expanding his business with cosmetics, so then we grew to a bigger counter, and then I became the business manager there. And then I sort of wanted to try a new brand, which was something from Sweden. It was called Byredo. And that was like a little bit more creative, a little bit more, it you know, stimulated my right brain. So I switched to it and I had more events. And then I wanted to go back to Tom Ford. So I've come back with Tom Ford now in Brickell, which is one of the newest markets. And it's the luxury market. But you learn a lot from the luxury market, because a lot of those clients, they have connections that you would not believe. So you just learn and you meet so many different kinds of people, and the right kinds of people, because the people that can open opportunities for you. So where I see myself in the future is probably brand management, either my own brand or maybe one of my clients' brands. So that's what I want to go into. And I always dreamed, I told her, like, I want my title to be Director of Wonderful. That's what I want my job title to be. So I'm going to create that eventually.
I think you're already developing it because you're thinking about it, you're putting it into motion.
Yeah, it'll most likely be a fragrance brand because fragrance is my passion. Like, I feel like fragrance changes your mood immediately. Like, when you smell somebody that smells good, you like immediately pay attention. Just like when you smell somebody that smells bad. I got into the Uber today, somebody came in, they had like, I don't know if they had food or something, but I was like, the smell was instant. So it, like, it changes your mood, it changes your experience.
Sure.
So fragrance speaks a lot to your mood and your experience and
it's one of the key
you like,
anchors, you know, scent. Things you remember from childhood, baked cookies, whatever it is. Scent is a key anchor. When they say an anchor, it brings you back to something in time.
Yeah.
And so Yezzy, music does the same thing.
Yezzy always wore Bulgari Omnia Crystalline, and that's whenever I smell that scent, like I immediately think of her. I followed someone like down the block. I was like, are you wearing Bulgari? And she's like, yes.
Yeah, it takes you there. Moments. Like moments are captured with senses. And scent is one of the key senses.
Yeah.
Tina, did you have a comment?
I wish I knew how to answer that question because, you know, I toy around with the idea of marketing a lot. I've been doing marketing for so many years now. I would say I would be very happy if I did stay in marketing, and I truly enjoy it, but you learn so many things being in marketing that I can't say exactly where I see myself in the future, if in what industry or what field I want to go into, but I can say with everything that I have learned in marketing, there are a lot of opportunities to do something different as far as going into communications or doing more cause-driven marketing. It just depends. I mean, it depends where it takes you. I mean, Whole Foods was extremely different than Aventura Mall, which was extremely different. What I was doing over here at FIU, and it's extremely different what I was doing before that, which was in the education field. So we'll see. I don't know.
Do you think retail, because you seem to be gravitating right now to retail, will be something you might want to consider again, or you think you're ready for a change completely?
I think retail is changing and shifting so much, but just in consumer behavior towards the retail industry and just how I feel personally, I feel like there is so much going on in the world right now and things are changing and I mean, you turn on the TV and there's a lot going on, especially with, you know, the election. So with that being said, not necessarily that I wanted to get into politics, probably not, but doing something more that I feel like I can relate to on a personal level, I feel like that's something where I would want to be.
That it resonates with you.
Absolutely.
I think we all feel that way. If you do something that you feel is important, it speaks to your soul. It does something where you're not working. You're doing something on a much deeper level. And companies that start in a place of philanthropy or cause, you sense that they're being authentic with the brand, that they really began there and didn't just adopt it, like, oh, let's get on the bandwagon, let's do something. You feel that authenticity. Are you sure there are no more questions while we were chatting? Like, go ahead.
How do you choose, like, a master's program that you want to go into? Because after, like, I graduate my undergrad, I feel like I can go so many directions. How do I narrow a master's program that I can get, like, the full benefit from in my career? And it wouldn't limit me if I try to, like, expand to a different direction. Like, I don't want it to be too niche, but I still want it to be broad enough where there's growth in my career.
Right. Going to grad school is, I mean, a very, very difficult and important choice. And personally, and this is a very personal story, when I was in undergrad, I was completely uninterested in being in school. I mean, as a matter of fact, in my sophomore year, I mean, one of my counselors called me in and said, hey, you know, if you don't like being in school, you don't have to be. You know, school's not for everyone. There's plenty of successful people that never went to school. Like, why? Just take a semester off and figure out what you want to do. And I took that very personally. I said, oh my God. Oh my God, she's telling me I can't do this. Or, you know, that I mean, maybe it was reverse psychology, I don't know. But anyway, I was a business major. And I decided to take a course in communication, and I never looked back. I went from like not being a great student at all to being an A student. And I loved being in school. And after I finished my undergrad program, I was so inspired by what I learned. And a lot of it was focused on, my undergrad was in communication studies. A lot of it was focused on intercultural communication and connecting with different people and audiences and different cultures that I researched. I started researching different programs. I never went to grad school thinking I'm going to get paid more, or I'm going to get a better job. It was just to kind of enrich myself more, and a really continuation to dive deep into what I had already learned in undergrad. And I started researching different programs, and I came across the Global Strategic Communication Program here at FIU. It was a fairly new program, but I researched the coursework and the curriculum. I loved the classes. I had a vision in mind that eventually I wanted to work for the UN and I was going to move to New York, and I thought Global Strategic Communication was like the best master's degree you could do for that. And it was. When I was researching the position that I wanted to do, it said a master's degree in global communication or communication studies. So that was what my plan was. That didn't happen because eventually I decided I didn't want to move to New York. But really spend some time trying to figure out what it is you want to do. And why you're making the choice you're making. Because don't just get a master's degree to say, oh, I have a master's degree. You know what I mean? It's not gonna do much for you. It's a lot of your time. It's the early to middle of your 20s, which is, you know, your time to get out there and work and network and all that. So just don't do, you know, master's just because everyone else is, or because, you know, your parents, you know, will respect you more, your peers will respect you more. It's really important to just do it because you feel like it's going to benefit you and you want to do it. And as far as choosing a program, go to the department heads, go to the professors, talk to them, network with them. I mean, they're the people that mm-hmm. teach the classes, and they've been in the field, and they have a breadth of knowledge and a willingness to help you and guide you in the right direction. So go to them and ask them, and sit in a couple classes and see if you enjoy it.
Be proactive. You know, do your homework. Prepare yourself. Think about, how does this fit into my life plan? How is this going to move me forward? What kinds of courses would be interesting to me? Just like when you take an opportunity for a job, look for a job that aligns with things that you're interested in, companies you want to work for, brands you want to market with. It isn't just, oh, it's a job, because you need to fit in corporate, into their corporate culture.
Right.
So you're fitting in, and not just, oh, I need a job, but I could do something at this company that would benefit them and me, and it's relevant. I resonate with whatever it is that they do. That would be something that would help you succeed in that particular company and in your career. Do you have any other questions that you thought of? Go ahead.
Okay, this is for you, Tina. Seeing as how the Aventura Mall is expanding, how will that, or if it hasn't already, how will that affect how you market and how you execute your plans?
Well, I would hope we will have a bigger team by the time the expansion is in fruition, which would be the end of this year in November. But it will change a lot. I mean, a lot of companies, they have in-house marketing teams. And certainly that's something we are shifting towards, expanding our marketing team, because at the moment we outsource a lot of what we do. We have a very small team for a very large center, but we work with a PR agency, we work with a social media agency, we work with a website agency, and we're working with a fourth agency for geolocation and geotargeting. So I feel that if we brought all of that in-house and we can manage it in-house, it would be a lot more beneficial to us and our team and time management. As the mall expands and the way we market ourselves shifts, I think we will start doing a lot more in-house and working locally rather from a more regional perspective.
No other comments? Well, I wanted to thank our speaker. Oh, we have a comment in the back. Go ahead.
Are either of you offering any internships?
Question is, do you have any internships available?
Any available?
Good question.
Yes, at Aventura Mall, we currently are looking for an intern. We're in the interviewing process, so.
I don't know if we have any internships right now. I think I read something about it on our website because I'm fairly new to the company. But I'll look into it and I'll send it to Professor Berman if anything comes up. Because a lot of times they do let people come in as interns and shadow different positions for buyers and retail managers and all the different positions that they have available.
No other questions? Okay. So our wonderful alums, our brilliant, wonderful former students of mine, Tina Varjabedian and Noël Valentine Walker. And I want to thank everybody for coming. And we look forward to having you at our very next webinar or seminar. in the Kopenhaver Center Leadership Seminar Series. Thank you so, so much.